The topic is Pi points, so let's go over all the different point types in Pi. First of all, we have the digital tags that I'd mentioned earlier. That would be the things that there's a finite number of them, like on, off, or red, green, and black. We do support that. Now, why would you do that instead of a string, you may ask? Well, because it's a lot easier to store in terms of resources, to store just on or either a 0 or a 1 indicating on and off instead of the actual string on and off. Red, black, and green can be stored as 1, 2, and 3 with a lot less space than storing them as those character strings. So that's the point in storing it like that, as a digital instead of a string. Now, we also support 16-bit integers and 32-bit integers. And again, it's the one you choose there is really just a matter of how much space you need to take and how large your number needs to be. And in the case of the N16, it actually is also important that you don't try to store any negative numbers with an int16 because we don't support that. To be honest, int16 is simply here to support a previous version of Pi in which that was one of the integer choices that that people had to make. So in a modern Pi system, we see very little interest in the int16s. Now, next up would be the floating point numbers. We have the float16s, the float32, and the float64. Now, by far and away, the most popular storage mechanism is the float32. The float32 is the default point type. If you don't set it to anything else, that's what you're going to get. It gives you very high precision. As you can see, 32-bit single precision reel. And it only takes about 5 bytes of space on disk when we store that, because it's 4 bytes for the float32 plus 1 byte for the time offset, and that's an offset from the previous value. We're not going to get into all those details, but the float32 is a very efficient way of storing the data. Now, the float64 is what you might use if you were interested in storing something at tremendously high precision. For example, we had a customer who said, hey, I want to store something from 0 to 10 million, and it needs to be accurate within 1/1000th of a unit. Well, something like that you would need to do not as a you couldn't do that as a float32, you do that as a float64. Now, the float16s, again, those are provided primarily to make the system compatible with earlier versions of Pi in which the float16s were the default. So we see very little current interest in that. There is no denying a float16 will take less space on disk than a float32. And it's not a bad way to store data. It does have its own problems, though. One of the biggest problems is its overall precision is only as great as the current time range of the Pi tag times 1 over 32,767. So you do store this with a lot less, you need less disk space to store this. It is more efficient in that regard, but the accuracy is the trade-off. We also support string tags. The string tag would be something you use for operator comments or, as I mentioned earlier, a batch ID, for example, something where you need both characters and numbers. We do store timestamps. People ask you, why in the world would you need a timestamp? Well, it's going to be something that is itself timestamped. You're basically storing a date. People say, why would you want that? Well, let's say, for example, you needed to record not the value that somebody entered, but the time at which the user entered that value. And what you could do is create a timestamp Pi tag, and then when you're entering this value, let's say it's a manual input, you can put in both the value and the timestamp at which that value was taken or pertains to. So you can envision, a time further down the road where you're entering both of these, but you still want to preserve when that sample was taken, for example, or when you got your results back. And then finally, as kind of a catch-all for things that we haven't thought of, is the blob tag. Blob stands for binary large object. It's not particularly large at this point because it only supports 976 bytes, but that is something that basically you can store as any kind of a binary format of a value that doesn't really fit in any of these other categories. Now, I do want to warn you, be careful how you choose your point type. Although you can change the point type later on, once you've made that assignment, and you can't even retain the history, it's not an easy process. So recommendation is just give it some good thought as to what point type you're going to choose. For most purposes, people will be using float32s, but there are other options available to you.